गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम टू TYBBA जनरल सेमिस्टर 5 एट आणंद कॉमर्स कॉलेज आणंद। दिस ऑनलाइन लेक्चर्स आर बीइंग डिलीवर्ड एज पर द गाइडेंस ऑफ द गवर्नमेंट ड्यू टू करंट COVID-19 पैंडेमिक सिचुएशन। Myself, प्रोफेसर देवांग त्रिवेदी shall engage you for the subject of business taxation 1 as per the syllabus prescribed by Sardar Patel University, Vallabh Vidyanagar and as available on its official website. Business taxation 1 course is divided into 4 units. Weightage of each unit is 25%. Standard reference books as prescribed and recommended by university for this subject are: number 1, Taxman's Student's Guide to Income Tax by Dr. Vinod K. Singhania and Dr. Monica Singhania. Second, Taxman Direct Tax Law and Practice by V.K. Singhania and Kapil Singhania. And third, Ahuja Girish and Ravi Gupta's Systematic Approach to Income Tax, published by Bharat Law House, Delhi. These books can be used as per your requirements and availability. Now, let's move to the unit number 1, that is conceptual framework and incidence of tax. The weightage of this unit is 25%. This unit consists of 100% theoretical contents. The first point is introduction to Income Tax Act. Friends, income tax is today an important source of revenue for governments in all the countries. It has become inevitable imposition because it has great potentials for raising funds for meeting the development and defense needs of the nation. There is enough evidence to show that taxes on income were levied since ancient times. Kautilya's discussion of taxation and expenditure, apparently in keeping with traditional doctrine, gave expression to 3 Indian principles. 1. Taxation power is limited. 2. Taxation should not be felt to be heavy or excessive. And 3, tax increase should be graduated. Once of these main concerns seems to have been the collection and expenditure of revenue in such a way as to build up the permanent revenue yielding capacity of the economy. Incidentally, these functional relationships between the rate of income tax and the magnitude of tax revenue is now expressed in the Dupont-Lefevre curve. Now, what are the objectives of income tax? The basic objective of taxation is to raise money needed to finance government expenditure. Taxes have other objectives too, as factors affecting the pricing of goods, they determine what to produce and in what measure. By taxing a different affluent society section, they aim to change the distribution of income and wealth. Now, what's the history of income tax? More than 3,000 years ago, the inhabitant of ancient Egypt and Greece used to pay income tax, consumption tax, customs duties. And these payments were made in various forms such as goods, days of unpaid labor, and fines. In ancient India also, a tax was levied on livestock and precious stones. In Athens, grains was taxed. So in different parts of the world, the taxes have been collected by various government from time to time as per their social structure, economic structure, and the political policies and the requirement and priority of the nation. In India, the 19th century saw the establishment of British rule, and the British government felt acute financial difficulties consequent to the freedom struggle of 1857. And to fill up the treasury, income tax was introduced for the first time in February 1860. And thereafter, there were many developments in the field of taxation in British India, and these were generally modeled on the pattern of taxation system existing in Britain at the relevant time. Taxation provision under the Indian Constitution says central government is authorized to collect tax revenue from income tax except on agriculture income, excise duty except on alcoholic drinks, and custom duties. State governments are authorized to get tax revenue from sales tax, value added tax, excise, and tax on agriculture income. Municipalities are entitled to get tax revenue from octroi and house property tax. If we look at the history of income tax in India, then briefly, as I told earlier, it started after 1857 freedom struggle. It was built obvious that in introducing the income tax in this country, the British officers would depend upon draw largely from the parent country's experience in tax laws and administration thereof. If we look at the history of income tax, then we can divide them broadly into three phases. The first period was a period of experiment, that is from 1860 to 1885, wherein a lot of experiments under the regime of British era happened in the tax administration. Then came the second phase of 1886 to 1914. During this time, a comprehensive tax laws were enacted by then British government and tried to streamline the administration for the enforcement, collection, and management of the taxation system in pre-independence era of this country. And then onwards, up to 1961, where the first Indian Income Tax Act was forced upon, that was a third phase. And then onwards also, up till now, there have been many changes, amendments have taken place in Indian Income Tax Act. At present, the Income Tax Act 1961 is in force in India. In 1956, the government referred the Income Tax Act to the Law Commission, which submitted its report in 1958. Direct Tax Administration Inquiry Committee was appointed in 1958 under the chairmanship of श्री महावीर त्यागी. ऑन द बेसिस ऑफ द रिकमेंडेशन ऑफ बोथ दिस बॉडीज द प्रेजेंट इनकम टैक्स एक्ट वॉज एनेक्टेड इन 1961 विच केम इन टू फोर्स ऑन 1st April 1962. दिस एक्ट ऑफ 1961 हैज बीन amended नंबर ऑफ टाइम सिंस देन. द इनकम टैक्स रूल्स 1962 हैव बीन फ्रेम्ड बाय द गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया अंडर द पावर्स ऑब्टेन्ड बाय इट अंडर द एक्ट फाइनेंस एक्ट 2015 मे बी टेकन एज द लेटेस्ट एग्जाम्पल ऑफ सच अमेंडमेंट्स मेड इन टैक्स लॉस. वेरियस कमिटीज हैव बीन अपॉइंटेड सिंस देन सच एज वांचू कमिटी, चौकसी कमिटी, चिलैया कमिटी टू सिंप्लीफाई द डायरेक्ट टैक्स लॉस एंड मेक देम मोर इफेक्टिव फॉर द पर्पज ऑफ इम्पोजिंग डायरेक्ट टैक्सेस. द नेवल लिमिट ऑफ इंडिया एक्सटेंड टू एरियाज विद इन 200 नॉटिकल माइल इन द सी फ्रॉम द बेस लाइन. एनी इनकम डिराइव्ड फ्रॉम सच एरिया इज ऑल्सो कंसिडर्ड टैक्सेबल. दैट इज इनकम फ्रॉम मिनरल ऑयल्स एक्सेट्रा प्रोड्यूस्ड इन सच एरिया इज टैक्सेबल. विद द एंडेवर्स टू सिंप्लीफाई द एक्ट इट हैज बीन मेड कॉम्प्रिहेंसिव एंड द एक्ट ऑफ 1961 रन्स इनटू 23 चैप्टर्स 298 सेक्शंस एंड 14 शेड्यूल्स. द बेसिक प्रिंसिपल्स ऑफ 1922 एक्ट हैव बीन रिटेन्ड इन द करंट एक्ट बट द प्रोसीजर्स हैव बीन फंडामेंटली चेंज्ड. द सेंट्रल बोर्ड ऑफ डायरेक्ट टैक्सेस पॉपुलरली नोन एज CBDT हैज ऑल्सो बीन एम्पावर्ड टू फ्रेम रूल्स एंड गाइडलाइंस एंड दे हैव टू बी इम्प्लीमेंटेड इन द सेम मैनर एज द एक्ट एंड द रूल्स. द बोर्ड नॉर्मली कंसिस्ट ऑफ 5 to 7 मेंबर्स. इंडियन इनकम टैक्स एक्ट 1961 इट इज द मेन एनेक्टमेंट रिगार्डिंग इनकम टैक्स. इट प्रोवाइड्स द स्ट्रक्चर एंड एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन ऑफ इनकम टैक्स. बाय स्टडिंग दिस एक्ट वन कैन नो विच पर्सन हैज टू पे इनकम टैक्स when and how he has to pay it. Besides, it incorporates the definitions of various types of incomes, their consumptions, deductions, and exemptions available, and the powers of various income tax authorities, procedures for assessment, etc. Income Tax Act extends to whole of India, including Jammu and Kashmir and Sikkim. For the purpose of income tax, the financial year and assessment year has been separately defined. And the taxpayer will have to comply with these two types of definitions. Having said that, now it is clear that the income tax is one of the most important area for administration, control and management for the economy of any nation. India, being a very large country, having a population of more than 1.3 billion people, and as per the dream of our present Prime Minister, Shri Narendra Bhai Modi, our economy is trying to achieve a $5 trillion mark. Now you can understand and imagine that from present less than $3 trillion to a dream of $5 trillion economy, how much tax revenue would be generated in the economy and what type of development that would bring to our economy. So the Indian Income Tax Act will have to be more dynamic, more flexible, more challenging and more forward-looking in the years to come, because we want to go from less than $3 trillion economy to a $5 trillion economy in near future. So having this brief background about the introduction to Indian Income Tax Act, now it is clear that the Indian Income Tax Act, how it works and what is its historical perspective and what it is trying to achieve. Now let's talk about various definitions as given in our Indian Income Tax Act. As you know that taxation is all about the law, and we have to understand various types of provisions that are mentioned in various sections of the Indian Income Tax Act. Now let's talk about the first definition, that is person. Gujarati ma apne kahiye vyakti. As per Income Tax Act, while defining SSE, we have seen that according to law, an SSE is a person by whom any tax is payable. Hence, the meaning of the term person requires clarification. Section 2, subsection 31 of the Act has given an inclusive definition of a person as follows. Person includes, number one, an individual, that is a natural person, human being. Second, a Hindu undivided family, that is HUF. Three, a company. Four, a firm. And five, an association of person or a body of individuals, whether incorporated or not. Six, a local authority. And seven, every artificial judicial person not included in the above six. For example, associated, association of person, body of individual, and artificial juridical person not formed with the motive of aiming profit or income have also been included in the definition of person. A statutory corporation or a Hindu idol, for example, Balaji of Tirupati are accessible under this clause. The definition has been added by the Act of 1961 and has been made exhaustive. The last subclause has made all artificial person like university, bar council, etc. liable to pay tax. Now, let's see the difference between association of person and body of individual. Association of person is one that is formed voluntarily, and any person can be member, that is individual as well as entities like company, firms, etc. Two or more persons join together for common purpose to earn income, they are called association of person. The co-heirs, co-legatees, co-donees, etc. joining together would be chargeable as an association of person. So there is a very broad understanding and definition of association of person as per the Income Tax Act 1961 under the definition of person. Now, body of individuals. It is formed under a law. Only individuals can be members. If a business is run by a widow for her own interest or on behalf of her children, it is to be assessed as body of individual. Co-executors or co-trustees would be charged and chargeable as body of individuals. So from the foregoing discussion, it is clear that as per section 3 subsection 42 of the General Clauses Act, the term person includes any company or association or body of individual, whether incorporated or not. An association of person may have companies, firms, joint families as its member. A body of individuals cannot have non-individual as its member. So all this is as per the Income Tax Act 1961. Now the second definition is of SAC. Now SAC, also known as a person who is liable to pay tax. Section 2, subsection 7 of Income Tax Act 1961 clearly defines the term SAC, A-S-S-E-S-S-E, that is called SAC. An SAC is a person by whom any tax or any other sum of money is payable under this act. This act means the Income Tax Act 1961, as amended from time to time. Any other sum of money may include interest, penalty, fringe benefit tax, etc., irrespective of the fact whether any legal proceedings has been taken or not. Every person in respect of whom any proceedings under this act has been taken for the assessment of his income or a fringe benefit or the income of any other persons in respect of which he is accessible or of the loss sustained by him or by such other person or the amount of refund due to him or to such other person, whether the person is liable to pay such amount or not. So, from the foregoing brief discussion about SSE, according to the Act, every person, remember, every person in respect of whom any proceedings under the Act has been taken for the assessment of the income of any other person in respect of which he is accessible or of the loss sustained by such other person or of the amount of refund due to such other person is also an SSE. Now this is law. We cannot make any changes. We cannot add anything or we cannot take out any word. This is strictly as defined in Income Tax Act 1961. Now see, in addition, it has been stated in the Act that SSE includes every person who is deemed to be an SSE under any provision of the Act. Deemed SSE would include, number one, trustees of a trust. Trust na je trustee ho che, eno pan ahiya samavesh karvama aayo che. Second, legal representative of deceased person under section 159. A person who is no more, a person who has died, એના જો legal representative હોય તો એ પણ કરવેરો ભરવાને પાત્ર બને છે. કોના? On behalf of the deceased person. Third, representative SSE of non-resident Indian under section 160 subsection 2. They are called agent of non-resident. બિન રહીશ ભારતીય છે એના રિપ્રેઝેન્ટેટિવ પણ કરવેરો ચૂકવવાને પાત્ર બને છે, એટલે દે કેન બી એન એસએસસી. નંબર ફોર, લીગલ ગાર્ડિયન્સ ઓર મેનેજર એન્ટાઇટલ ટુ રિસીવ ધ ઇન્કમ ઓન બિહાફ ઓફ માઇનર, લ્યુનેટિક ઓર ઇડિયટ. વેરી સિમ્પલ. એન્ડ લાસ્ટ બટ નોટ લીસ્ટ, કોર્ટ ઓફ વોર્ડ્સ, દેટ ઇઝ ઓફિશિયલ ટ્રસ્ટી, રિસીવર એન્ટાઇટલ ટુ રિસીવ income on behalf of any other person, official trustee hoy ke court of ward hoy ke koi property na receiver appoint thayla hoy ane emne jo koi avak prapt thati hoy to e pan avak vera kayda 1961 pramane e SSE tarike kar vera bharvane patra bane che. Number 4, that is D, SSE according to the Act includes every person who is deemed to be an SSE in default under any provision of this Act. SSE in default means what? એટલે in default કોઈ SSE આપણે એને કઈ રીતે કહી શકીએ? તો a person who fails to deduct or remit TDS under section 191. TDS ના કાપ્યો હોય અને ભરવાને પાત્ર થતો હોય તો એને પણ આપણે અહીંયા SSE તરીકે ગણી શકીએ. સેકન્ડ, અ પર્સન હુ ફેલ્સ ટુ પે ટેક્સ એન્ડ એની અધર સમ ડિમાન્ડેડ અંડર સેક્શન 220. સેક્શન 220 પ્રમાણે એની જોડે ઇન્કમ ટેક્સ ખાતું જો કોઈ પેનલ્ટી કે એની જોડે કરવેરો માગે એવી નોટિસ આપે તો પણ એને એસએસસીની કેટેગરીમાં આપણે મૂકી શકીએ છીએ. નાવ રિમેમ્બર દેટ એવરી એસએસસી અંડર ધ ઇન્કમ ટેક્સ એક્ટ લો મસ્ટ બી અ પર્સન, બટ એવરી પર્સન ઇઝ નોટ નેસેસરીલી એન એસએસસી. યાદ રાખજો કે દરેક પર્સન, એવરી પર્સન એ એસએસસી હોવો જરૂરી નથી, પણ દરેક એસએસસી એ પર્સન હોવો જરૂરી છે. ફોર એક્ઝામ્પલ, ઇફ અ સિનિયર સિટીઝન ઇઝ હેવિંગ એન એન્યુઅલ ઇન્કમ ઓફ સે 290,000 વિચ ડઝ નોટ ક્રોસિસ એન એક્ઝેમ્પશન લિમિટ ઓફ સે 5 લેક્સ, દેન હી ઇઝ નોટ એન એસએસસી ધો હી ઇઝ એ પર્સન. ક્લિયર? સો ટુડે વી હેવ ડિસ્કસ્ડ 3 મેજર પોઈન્ટ્સ. વન ઇઝ ઇન્ડિયન ઇન્કમ ટેક્સ એક્ટ, દેટ ઇઝ ધ ઇન્ટ્રોડક્શન ટુ ઇન્કમ ટેક્સ એક્ટ, એન્ડ વી હેવ ટેકન 2 ડેફિનેશન્સ ઓનલી. ધ ફર્સ્ટ ઇઝ પર્સન એન્ડ ધ સેકન્ડ ઇઝ એન એસએસસી. ઓકે, વી સ્ટોપ હિયર ધ ફર્સ્ટ પાર્ટ. ધ સેકન્ડ પાર્ટ વિલ ફોલો નેક્સ્ટ ટાઈમ.